So in the summer of 2020, when we heard from David Bendingston that the widow of William Corey was looking for an archival home for his entire life's work, his camera, his photographs, his negatives, prints, all aspects of his career as a photographer, we were just absolutely over the moon excited about the possibility. His work fits into our collections in a couple really important ways. One of them is our interest in visual culture, and in particular documentary photography. The way that people interact with their natural environment, with cultural environments, how they attempt using all kinds of different photographic technology to capture a particular environment is something that is endlessly fascinating to us, and we try and build collections that demonstrate a variety of different approaches to that kind of work. Also, William Corey as a person is a bridge to another culture in a way that resonates with us here at the university. So as an American, going to Japan and really becoming a bridge to Japanese culture for the United States, taking photographs of very traditional Japanese cultural objects like gardens, landscape design, and making that available and accessible to an American audience is really important work. And as an institution that was involved in the founding of what's now Hokkaido University in Sapporo, it's always been critical for us to continue to build that bridge to Japanese culture, between Japanese culture and the United States. So William Corey, in many ways, is the perfect analog to that for us. And it's just an absolute privilege to be able to preserve and provide access to his work well into the future.
My name is David Bendixson. Here at Special Collections, University Archives at UMass, and we're very fortunate to have William Corey's negatives and prints and the camera that he took most of his life's work on. This is a 8x20-inch Corona panoramic view camera. It's very large compared to other cameras, and that's important because everything William Corey did was filled with dedication and commitment in his work. And part and parcel of that was the technology he used. So this camera is unique. It's rare to find these. They're large and difficult to use. So it takes some dedication. We all know what 35 millimeter film looks like. So about an inch per frame. Other large format view cameras are about yay large, and this is his. So you can see the difference in size. That's a lot of real estate and a lot to carry around. We spent quite a lot of time simply unpacking it. It took two people if you don't know what you're doing. Just to say a word about William Corey's work and the camera he used, it's over 100 years old, and they don't really make them like this, so it took some dedication to use that his whole life, and to get film for it was also a struggle. He had to custom order 8x20-inch sheets that go in these holders from Kodak. That's a commitment to do that and decide you're going to go with it. It's a lot more difficult to use. And the prints as well, we're very fortunate to have some large prints of Williams. And the technology used to print those colored images is Fujiflex, and it's a printing technology it's a craftsmanship to accomplish, and there are only a few places in the world that do it well. So we're very fortunate to have the full breadth of his life's work, from the tools he used to make images, to the negatives, to the prints themselves.
My name is John Einarsen, and I'm a photographer and editor of the Kyoto Journal. So I've lived in Kyoto over 30 years, and I've been here at the same time that William Corey was coming and photographing the Japanese gardens. But I didn't really know about him until about a few years ago. And I was very impressed by this work. You know, no one has photographed the Japanese gardens with such single-mindedness and using such high-quality equipment. His objective was to catch the fidelity of the garden, to be truthful to the garden, so that he wanted to express it as it was. So I was very impressed when I first heard of him and saw his work. And being a photographer, I understand the moment in one's life where you decide to devote your life to some special subject. So he was so deeply touched by the Japanese gardens, and we can see that from his photographs, that he devoted his life to making these photographs. And he did not take a simple path. Of course, he could have photographed them with 35 millimeter cameras and so on, but he decided to capture them properly and truthfully. He needed to use large format cameras. And so he used an 8x10 view camera at first. And so the 8x10 has a large negative. This is an 8x10 black and white negative. And so he was using this size but color film. And this is a photograph that he took at Heian Shrine of fallen cherry petals. And this was taken with an 8x10. And of course, color film is much more sensitive than black and white film, so it's a little bit more tricky to handle, transport, so you have to be very, very careful with it. But at some point, he decided that the 8x10 wasn't enough, so he decided to use a 8x20 banquet camera, which was a panoramic camera from the early 20th century that was the size of two 8x10 negatives. So the negatives were this size. He had to specially order them, and he was able to capture images like this, which no other photographer has photographed, the classic Kyoto gardens, in this format. And so, because it's a large format negative, the detail is astonishing. They're just, you can pick out single leaves, even when it is enlarged. So he was making the photographs with that camera. When he was composing the camera, because it's ground glass, everything was upside down. So this is what he was actually seeing when he was composing the photograph. So, that is much more difficult, but the final photograph, this one of Rengeji Garden in Kyoto, you can see that he was very aware of the vertical rhythm of the posts going from left to right, and how the space between them was very important, and how certain elements appeared in those spaces, like the rock in the pond and the stone lantern, such that the whole became a harmony. So this is quite arduous process because you have to move a big camera slightly many times to get everything to line up the way you see it in your mind. So this process was the most difficult way to photograph a Japanese garden, but the result were these tremendous, beautiful, detailed negatives that could be enlarged. And one other aspect is that because it's a view camera, because the aperture's small, and you your exposures are long. So maybe several minutes or up to 15 minutes or even more. So it's not like a shutter, like clicking to capture the photograph. It's more like a gathering of light. You're opening the shutter and gathering the light in over time. And this gives an effect of a kind of glow. So his images have this kind of otherworldly glow to them, or aura about them. And so he was very particular about the moment that he actually began to open the shutter. And that was something he kind of felt in his heart, that this is the time I need to make the exposure. And that is something that's very mysterious. Thank you.
He's a photographer from Boulder. I mean, an amazing technician, the way that he was able to master the camera. But what happened was is that he was taking sort of architectural work. He was doing a lot of different types of photography, and then fell in love. The love of his life brought him to Japan and showed him these Japanese gardens, and he became the foremost photographer of Japanese gardens in the world, and was actually had the honor of having a piece installed by the royal family of Japan and did residencies there, and was able to bring that mastery of photography and the idea of Japanese gardens as an art form themselves, and brought those two things together.
Hi, my name is Derek Okubo, and I'm the Executive Director of the Agency for Human Rights and Community Partnerships with the City and County of Denver, Colorado. It gives me great pleasure to provide a few thoughts on the late William Corey's photography, which we prominently displayed in 2015 in Denver International Airport in celebration of the commencement of our direct flight between Denver and Tokyo. Soon after we put up the pictures, I sat there in the waiting area and observed many passengers who were scurrying and hurrying by to make their destinations. And occasionally, more than occasionally, there were people who glanced and saw the photographs, slowed down, and then actually stopped and turned and just studied the pictures. And then I'd watch them move from one to the other, and then to the other. That's what William's pictures do. They capture you, they grab you, and it's almost like you're sitting there in your living room looking out a huge picture window at an incredible landscape. Only his pictures have a level of detail that even the eye cannot capture. So when you take a look at William's pictures, the legacy that he leaves behind, has left us, is through those incredible photographs. And like the others, I hope you take the time to stop and take a look and study the incredible gift that William has left us. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Gil Asakawa, and I am a journalist and an appreciator of the arts, and a fan of William Corey's photography, because I love Japan, I love photography, and I love his attention to detail, his ability to use the large format cameras, pretty unusual tool in this day and age to capture the soul of these gardens that he photographed in Japan. And my only regret is that although I live in Colorado, I never got the chance to meet him in person. And so I wanted to express my appreciation for his work and the fact that I'm so glad that his work, his legacy, lives on and is available for the world to enjoy moving forward.
Hello, my name is Dana Strout. I was a friend of Bill Corey's for over 20 years, and his wife Reimi asked me if I might say a few words about his work, since he and I were both photographers. Bill's work is some of the most incredible photography of Japanese gardens you will ever see, anywhere, at any time. I knew Bill for a long time, and I knew how he worked. The work that you see here in this exhibition is not just a collection of very, very beautiful images of trees or lakes or ponds, but Bill, through his work, through his dedication, was actually able to capture the soul of his subject, the essence of what his subject was all about. Bill would study an image sometimes for hours, sometimes for days, sometimes for weeks, before he finally put the camera on a tripod to take the picture. And when he did, those images, those exposures lasted anywhere from a few seconds to sometimes a few hours. And during that period of time, something very miraculously happens. The soul of the image enters the camera, it enters the film, and it enters Bill. When Bill produced these images, he was able to produce what he saw as the soul of each image. And that soul today lives on in this exhibition. Bill used an incredibly large camera. He worked incredibly slowly, and as a result, was able to produce something that no one else has yet produced. I encourage you to walk through this exhibition slowly. Study the images. Just don't look at them as a pretty picture. Study what he's trying to say. Study what it meant to him. And when you do that, a part of that image, a part of the soul of that subject will enter you, as well as a part of Bill's soul will enter you as well. You're very privileged to be able to see this work here. I encourage you to take your time to study the images, and I want to thank you very much for being a part of this exhibition.
デザイナーの宇賀谷瑠璃と申します。私はこう、ね、あの日本庭園のデザインの仕事以外に、日本庭園のこう見方や魅力っていうのを皆さんにお伝えする仕事をしておりまして、ここにありますこういう本、最新刊はこういう美しい苔の庭っていうんですけれども、こういう本を通して皆さんが日本庭園を、ね、身近に感じていただけるような、そういうことをやったり、講座とか講演で日本庭園の魅力をお伝えしております。で、私からこう見た、ウィリアム・コーリーさんのこうお写真の魅力というのをね、お話しさせていただきたいんです。で、ウィリアムさんの日本庭園の写真を初めて拝見した時にこうびっくりしたんですけれども、非常にこう詳細、ディテールがこう写っている。でこうそれっていうのは私たちのこう見ている景色よりさらにこう詳しい情景だったり、葉っぱ一枚一枚であったり、そういうのがこう写っているんですよね。でそれがこうびっくりしまして、でこうそれでお聞きするとこう、ね、撮っておられたカメラっていうのがバンクエットカメラっていう、こうね、すごく遠くまでピントが合うというカメラで撮ってらしたからというのをお聞きして納得しました。で、ちょっとねこう見ていただくと、こういうふうに、ね、後ろの方のこういうさつきの一枚一枚の葉っぱ、こういうのってね普通のカメラではね一つ一つは 映らないんですよ。でこのお花であったり、それがこう全てピントが合ってますよね。こうよくわかるのはこういうモミジの葉っぱの細かいところとかも全部綺麗に映ってるんです。でこう私たちの目線っていうのはここまでのディテールっていうのは実はこうパッと見では見れないんですよね。だからこう私たちが見るよりもさらに深い景色っていうのがウィリアムさんの写真から伝わります。そういうので見るとね、私たちがこう見れない景色まで見せてもらっているという、そういうね日本庭園のこう魅力がさらにウィリアムさんのこう写真で深まります。でこれなんかは四川堂さんのね、日本庭園なんですが、皆さんねいつ一度は行かれたことがあると思います。このね紅葉の一枚一枚の葉っぱ、これまで写ってるんですよね。こういう詳細がもう綺麗に写り込むっていう写真はね、今まで私も見たことがなかったんですね。なので構図が美しいし、こうね景色の切り取り方も美しいんですけど、それにプラスこのディテールですね、これがこうきっちり写り込む、そういうのがこうウィリアムさんの目を通した日本庭園のね美しさ魅力だなと思います。で、ね、その中でも私がすごく好きなウィリアムさんの、お写真っていうのを選ばせていただきました。でウィリアムさんのこう、ね、お写真、これは 8×10 というものになるんですが、こうやってこう見ていただくと桜の花びらの一枚一枚が全部綺麗に写っているんですよね。でもうこれを見た時にもうなんかこう夢のような世界にいるなと思ったんですが、こういうこうさりげない情景を撮られるのも上手な方だなと。日本庭園のこう美しさを切り取られるだけじゃなくって、私たちがこう何気に日常の中こう見ている景色、そういうのをこう美しく捉えるっていうのも上手な方なんだなっていうので、この一枚はとっても好きです、ね、なんかこうこの根っこのねこう切り取り方と葉っぱの構成っていうのが非常に美しいですよね。で、次は同じく桜なんですよね。ね平安神宮のしだれ桜になります。私多分何度もこの景色見てるんですけど、私が今まで見た景色よりずっと綺麗に写っているんです。でこのピンクのねこう深みといいますか、それプラスやはり向こうの方までこう焦点が合っている、ピントが合っているので、こう奥深いこのピンクのね世界っていうのが写っていて、それがねしだれ桜って本当そういう一個一個がこう分かるととても魅力的なお花なんですよ。だそういうこうウィリアムさんのこう視点っていうものがこういうねお花から伝わるっていうのも素敵です。そして、私も大好きなねお庭、二ノ瀬にある白龍園さんというお庭なんですが、これは春と秋だけね特別公開されてまして、私がウィリアムさんのお写真を知るきっかけになったのもこの白龍園さんが繋いでくださったからなんです。でそういう意味でねなんかこう運命的なものをこう感じるお庭が白龍園なんですが、これね白龍園さん6月ぐらいになると雪の下のお花がこの石の階段に一斉に咲くんですね。でこれはね本当に私美しいと思うんですが、今もねたくさん咲くんですが、ウィリアムさんが撮られたこの時期っていうのはまだ一般に公開されてない時期だったので、ほとんど人がこう歩いてないんですよね、石段が。なのでお花がねたくさん今よりも咲いてるんです。今はどうしてもこう人が通るのでお花の数が減ってしまっているんですが、この頃は本当にたくさん咲き誇っていて、でそのねこう昔のこう美しい姿をとどめて いらっしゃるっていうのもなんですが、雪の下って本当に細かいお花なんですよ。でその一個一個のね花弁までも それもどこまでもがねはっきり映っているっていう、これはね本当にあの普通にも今簡単に iPhone とかで撮れますが、 iPhone とかには絶対撮れない景色なんです。なんかこれを見た時本当にねわーっていう歓声が上がりました。でこういうこうお写真からも分かるんですが、ウィリアムさんのこう視点っていうのはとてもこう繊細でして、あの日本庭園 の, こうあの全体の美しさだけでなく、こう木々花、ね、葉っぱの一枚一枚それをこう撮られるのがとても素敵で、プラスなんかこうその時の空気感そういうのもねこう写真の中に映り込んでいて、そういうのを、ね、あの見せていただくのがとってもこう楽しいです。そしてあのやはり日本庭園やこういう景色っていうのはだんだんこう変わっていくんですよね。でそれはこうあのいいように変わっていったり、でこうちょっとメインテナンスが悪くなっていったり、さまざまな変化っていうのはもう仕方がないんです。でこう木が枯れたりとか、こうねこの花がもうここにはないとか、そういうのがねどうしても出てくるんですが、ウィリアムさんのお写真の魅力っていうのはその昔のその姿、それをね留めておいてくださっている、記録してくださってるっていう、そういうところにも非常に大きな価値があると思います。あのやっぱり誰かが残さないとこういうものっていうのは残っていかないんですよね。それをこう、こういう高画質残していただくと、例えばあの大きな台風とかが来てお庭がこうねあの潰れてしまって、次修復しようっていう時に多分ねこのウィリアムさんの写真っていうのがすごく役に立ったりするんです。だからこうそういう記録、あの一つの歴史を残すという記録という意味でもとてもねあの価値の高いお写真だなと思います。なのでこうね芸術アートとしての美しさ、日本庭園をこう知る美しさのこう写真、そしてそういうねアーカイブ記録としての、ね、写真の価値、そういうのをね兼ね備えておられるなと思います。ね、私もあの大不安なのでこうやってこうゆっくり拝見するのはね、なんかこう私自身の心のこうねなんか癒しにもなっています。ね、なので皆さんにもゆっくりウィリアムさんの写真を、ご覧いただきたいなと思います。